From Matthew 1 through 6 and 16 through 18. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do, in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head, wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. The word of the Lord.
I think more than normal from past weeks. Let's pray after that video. Jesus, we thank you for just being able to approach Christmas Day here as we get closer to celebrating your birth. God, may your birth be something we actually celebrate every day. May that not be something that we just hold for once a year. And so we ask that this year, God, that you would reveal some new things. You would make your incarnation even more real in our lives. Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity to be together this morning. We thank you for how your spirit has already been speaking. We pray that in the rest of our time together that you would just continue that. God, as Scott prayed, may our hearts be open to the work that you want to do within us this morning. May you encourage where we need encouragement. May you challenge where we need challenge. May we be open to either or to both here this morning. God, I pray in these next few moments that there would not be one word that comes from my mouth that would not be of you. Just bless this moment together in Jesus' name. Amen. Morning, I'm Jake. I'm one of the pastors here. And I don't know about you, but it feels like that video really encapsulated the week, right, as we get ready for Christmas. This was the week of getting extra shopping done, wrapping everything. We actually had the fun privilege of we locked the closet that all of our presents were in from the wrong side, and we got locked out, and so I had to pull the doorknob off, and it took us a good hour just to try to figure out how to get back into the room, trying to explain to our kids, sorry, no Christmas. Presents are locked in the closet. And we capped off kind of our busy week by going to the Sono Mall yesterday. They had this selfies with Santa event, which was really fun. And so we took a number of photos. This would have been the one I had shared on social media if I had found it. It was a really fun time at the mall, and yet this picture doesn't quite tell the full story of the experience. And what's really fun is live photos, right? If your phone does that, it actually it takes a picture of 3 seconds of content. And so sure enough, just a half second earlier, probably tells a more accurate picture of what was happening. We had to bribe my son to even go over there. I don't want to be in a picture. He sat down and the snowflake touched him. And so it was like, that's what garnered that face. You can't totally see it, but my daughter is looking off in the distance because she is like, she wants to know what's next. There was so much energy and stimulation going on. They were given cotton candy as soon as they walked in the door. So of course the sugar high started quickly. By the end of it, we were toast. We were sensory overloaded. Even my kids were like, we need introvert time by the end of that time. And so this is kind of why we've been doing this series of Decluttering Christmas. And I think as we're getting closer, we maybe are feeling that even more. The increased pace, the extra expectations, the pressure to find the perfect gifts and make sure everything is wrapped just perfectly. The go, go, go of the season. And so over the last few weeks, we've been talking about spiritual practices to help us declutter our lives this Christmas. And so week one, we talked about simplicity, which really was about decluttering from our stuff. Week two, we talked about silence, which was decluttering from noise, and not just the external noise, but also our internal emotions and our thoughts that might not be very helpful. Last week, Ben talked to us about decluttering our time as we talked about Sabbath and the importance of rest and finding peace in the midst of our lives. And this week, we're going to talk about another practice that we're calling sacred sharing. Because the reality is we live in a tell-all world. We don't hold our sharing about our lives in a very sacred way. And in fact, we actually have a very fragmented approach to a lot of the sharing about our lives that we either do share or don't share. And Pastor Susie Silk, she breaks it down into three different categories. And so first, we share about our lives in the public way. This is our best self. And oftentimes it's curated. So for a lot of us, this is your social media platform. This is the picture, the perfect one that you picked in order to tell a specific story. This is why when you go to lunch, you take 20 photos of your sandwich to make sure you're getting just the right lighting and just the right angle and just the right amount of things within the picture so that you can share it on Instagram. Or if you think about going to a public event, when's the last time that you went to a concert or a comedy club and you actually just experienced it with your eyes instead of actually through your screen? I remember being at an event once and somebody was actually using their iPad right in front of me and they're holding it up and I was so annoyed just sitting right in back of them that it just totally blocked my view. But that's kind of this mentality that we have. It's almost like this idea of if we don't share it with the world, did it actually happen? Was I really there? I mean, think about Christmas morning, especially those of us who are parents, right? Are we going to actually watch our kids open their presents, or are we going to be spending the time taking 200 photos to go over later so we have the perfect story for our social media platform or the perfect pictures to send out later to tell this story, to curate this moment of this beautiful Christmas morning and that we're good parents because we got these gifts for our kids and look at how happy we actually are. And so there's the public side of us that we tend to curate so that we look good, so that we can find approval. The next level is our private lives. And this is that we have a small group of people who actually do see our weaknesses. But in a lot of cases, it actually happens by accident. We maybe even resent that they even know those things about us. We're worried about them being held over our heads. And so we reluctantly kind of share some of our mistakes, some of our things like that we'd rather not know, but I guess they do, and it is what it is. And so we kind of approach it in a very tender, sensitive way. And then the next step is our secrets. These are the shameful, the embarrassing things. In a lot of ways, these are the things that we think if we share this, we're going to be penalized somehow. We're going to lose something. It's going to cost us status, power, a job, a relationship. And so God forbid, we don't want to share our mental health challenges or that sin or that mistake. We have to keep those things close because if I let those out, if I let this become public and don't keep it as a secret, it's going to be socially embarrassing. It's going to have really negative consequences. Which leads us to a question of simply why do we tend to share our lives this way? And quite simply, it's because we're looking for likes. We're looking for affirmation. We're looking for approval. And really, this is a human condition thing that we all wrestle with that started right off in the garden. Is the creation narrative in Genesis 1 says that God gave his full blessing to Adam and Eve. They were created in the image of God. And the temptation of the serpent was, no, God's holding out on you. You're not enough. You need a little bit more. And so immediately they start to look for affirmation and approval in one another from the serpent. They go against what God had been telling them. And so we all have this innate thing to be looking for the approval for others. And just to be clear, this isn't just about social media. If you're not on social media, you're not immune to this. If you've ever had coffee with a friend or been at a dinner party, have you ever met a person who just is always ready to one-up you? I know that's nobody in this room, but have you ever met somebody like that, that you tell their story and they're like, oh, that's where you went on vacation? Well, let me tell you where I went. Let me tell you about the club that I'm part of. Hey, have you seen my cool new Tom's shoes? Do you know that every time you buy one of these, it actually helps somebody in a third world country get a pair of shoes too? How great am I? The makeup that I buy is all organic and it's not tested on animals. Isn't that cool? Hey, do you hear the donation that my family's foundation made last week? So we like run into these people that we socially are looking for approval. We're looking for likes. We're looking for affirmation. And frankly, many of us are actually addicted to that sense of approval. And John Ortberg actually cautions us that addiction to approval, seeking approval, doesn't actually lead to long-lasting approval. But instead, it creates these never-ending cycles. First off, it leads us into comparison. We're scrolling Instagram not because we want to see our friends' kids or see what people our friends are up to, but we're actually almost creating a bucket list off of what everyone else is doing. We want to keep up with the Joneses. We want to make sure that our lives are measuring up to what everyone else is doing. And so as soon as we think we've made it, as soon as we've garnered approval, oh, well, now there's another thing, and now there's another thing, and now there's another thing. Which can eventually lead us to deception. Frankly, it becomes beyond just curating the best photo to posting a photo that couldn't be further from the truth. Again, let's use Christmas as an example. Maybe your family is in a really tough spot this holiday season. Maybe your marriage is on the verge of breaking down. Things are really challenging at home, and yet you curate that really perfect Christmas morning photo of everybody smiling, everything is happy, everything is perfect, and it's actually almost a deception from reality, not just the best of the photos. And so some of our posturing for approval is just flat-out lies. You don't actually care about that cause, you're just trying to look good for your Twitter followers and for other people. And then next, Ortberg says it can lead to resentment. Because what happens when we're looking for approval and we don't actually get it? I feel like this happens a lot with our parents. As kids, as grown children, trying to seek the approval of our parents, and some of us, it's just like you kind of never get to that point. No matter what you do, it's like never good enough. And so it leads to resentment as you're looking for that approval and people don't give it to you. And so this constant share all, looking for approval just doesn't work. And Jesus invites us into something different. Verse 1 of chapter 6 is the thesis for the whole chapter. And Jesus says, beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. And then Jesus goes on to give us three examples. The first one is about giving. When you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogue and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. So obviously, this is hyperbole. This is not literal trumpets on the corner streets. But the point he's making is that people were giving at this time, and it was like they were blasting a trumpet, which are loud. Everybody around could have heard. The equivalent would be when the offering basket goes around, as if before you put in a contribution, you were like, hey, everybody, it's going in. It's going in. Everybody see? All right, here it goes. Like, it's calling attention to ourselves. Then Jesus talks about prayer. And he says, when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. And so once again, it's this posturing. It's out in public on the streets. It's on the stage. It's having the postures, maybe even having the style of dress. You're praying in a way that when you get off the stage, you want people to come up to you and say, oh, that was such a beautiful, elegant prayer. That was so nice. Verse 7 even takes it a step further, where he talks about Gentiles praying with their many words. And this was because of the polytheistic nature of the Gentile communities, that they had to pray to all of the gods just to make sure that they like got the right one. And so they pray to that one, and then to this one, and then to that one, and then to this one, and they just go on and on and on and on in order that their prayers might be heard. And then the last example that Jesus gives is fasting. And this was just the perfect picture for this. How many of you have fasted or know somebody who's fasted who look like this all day, right? When you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. So this is fasting and then spending the day complaining about how hungry you are. Purposely scheduling a lunch meeting so that as the other person is ordering, they're like, are you getting food? Oh, no, I'm fasting. It's looking sullen and down and complaining and whining again, all to get the attention. So within those examples, there's this repetition that we hear. One of them is this term, hypocrites. And we think of that term as saying one thing and doing another, but the term actually has a little bit of a different connotation in the biblical language. Because hypocrite literally referred to an actor in Greek society who gave public performances. And so Jesus isn't getting at somebody who's doing one thing in public and another thing in private. What Jesus is saying is that there's this public display that's a fake. It's a performance. They're putting on a show and they are seeking applause. The other thing that Jesus says is that these hypocrites, they have received their reward. And that word in Greek literally means dues paid for work. So in other words, what Jesus is saying is that as we live as a hypocrite, as a performer, as an actor, we have contracted to play a role. And as we get our applause, our payment, our reward has been given. The job has been completed, and it's done. So some warm and fuzzy questions for us. Am I a hypocrite? Do I grumble when my actions aren't noticed or congratulated? Am I envious when others get credit and I don't? I think especially sometimes with like work projects, right? You maybe worked on a team and one of your team members gets all the credit and you're like, what the heck? Do I complain when I don't get my wish and I feel like I deserve it because I gave that much, because I serve and I give all of my time and so I should get what I want? Do I count the benefit to myself before I give or serve? Now, hopefully those questions feel a little bit uncomfortable. And let's just be honest, there's nobody in this room that can answer no to all of those questions all the time. We all have moments and times that we're saying yes, because again, it's this human condition of seeking approval. It is a normal thing to seek approval, to want approval from the people around us. But Jesus invites us into something different. And Jesus goes on in these three examples to talk about this practice of secrecy, to talk about sacredly sharing different parts of our lives. When you give, don't even let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. So, I mean, how much of an extreme contrast is that? Going from the trumpet on the corner of the street so all that might hear, and yet somehow he's saying to give in a way that your left hand and your right hand are not even knowing what's happening. I'll be honest, this verse is something that I struggle with every year when it comes time for taxes. Am I honoring this when I put all of my charitable giving in my taxes? Does that disrupt the motivation of why I gave in the first place? Is that not keeping my giving secret? And I don't know the answer to that, but I think that's the invitation that we get brought into with sacred sharing and thinking about why we're doing what we're doing. When you pray, go into your room and shut the door. Now, this would not have been going to your bedroom. First century Jewish homes did not have separate bedrooms. Likely, this was the food pantry in the center of the home. And so Jesus is saying is go into the center of the home where there's not even windows that people can't even see what's happening. Shut the door. That's where you can talk to me. And then similarly with fasting. Instead of looking gloomy and down and whining about being hungry, actually anoint your face with oil. Wash your face so that as you're going about in everyday life, people don't even have the ability to say like, hey, are you okay? But they're just like, wow, you look great today. And you're like, thanks. And so there's this invitation to do our acts of righteousness, not in public for everyone to see, but instead in secret. Which leads us to an interesting question. If you're familiar with the Sermon on the Mount, there almost feels like that Jesus is contradicting himself here for a moment. It's chapter 5, verse 16, Jesus is talking about being light in the world, salt in the earth. And he says, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So does Jesus want us to let our light shine, or are we supposed to do things in secret? And the answer to that is yes. See, there's a key component here, verse 16 here of chapter 5. Let your work shine before others so that they might give glory to the Father. Sacred sharing invites us to declutter our motivations of who we're looking for approval from. I love what Susie Silk says about this dynamic. Jesus says, go and build a theater in your life that only has one seat, and it's for God. If someone happens to walk by and watch the show, then so be it. And a great example of this from a couple years ago was the Red Sox right fielder Mookie Betts. After game 2 of the 2018 World Series, he had a great game. The Red Sox were up 2-0. And he went home and had been delivered a tremendous amount of food. And it was way more than him and his friends and family could eat. And so at 2 in the morning in 37-degree weather, right after winning a game in the World Series, he took all of that food, put it in a shopping cart, and went out to the Boston Public Library to deliver it to the homeless people who were there. But Mookie, he didn't tweet about it. He didn't invite other people to join him. It was him and one of his best friends. They went down there. They purposely bundled up. The homeless people afterwards had accounted. They didn't even realize it was Mookie Betts. And the only reason it came to light is a fan happened to walk by and happened to recognize him and took a picture and called into the local radio station to let them know about it. And then it became a national story. That's exactly what Susie is getting at. Having this pure motivation of doing what you're supposed to want to be doing, doing it for God, doing it not to get anything back, and then if someone happens to walk by and watch, then great. And this aspect of sacred sharing, this is even what Jesus did. I mean, how many times did he heal somebody or perform a miracle and yet say, don't go tell anyone? Even thinking about the birth of Jesus. Jesus came into the world. God became flesh in one of the most unassuming ways. Born to a refugee family on the run. Born out in the middle of nowhere. Visited by shepherds and foreigners. In a lot of ways, Jesus really came into the world and took on flesh and blood in a very secretive way. Not the public display that our culture might think about. And I even think about the same thing for Christ's death and resurrection. His death was a public spectacle put on by a big show by the Roman government, put up on a hill. And yet his resurrection was observed by two women. And then he started to appear to his disciples. It's like Jesus needs a new marketing plan to flip those things around, right? Let's bury the death, the secretive thing, the bad thing, and then like let's like announce, hit the resurrection, like come to the grave, 6 a.m., Sunday morning, everybody come. But instead, Jesus practiced it a little bit differently. The way that we share our lives and the aspect of sacredly sharing it
gets flipped on its head. We're told in scriptures over and over again that we can confess to one another. We should forgive one another. We can bear with one another's faults. It's almost like the public persona is not supposed to look great all the time. But in humility, we can present our weaknesses and things. Then when we get into our private lives, it's not by accident, but it's actually purposely engaging in vulnerability with safe and appropriate people. It's us working to be safe and appropriate people for others. That we would encourage one another, love one another, come alongside one another. We don't need to be ashamed. Then the secret things, it's actually the good deeds. It's the acts of righteousness. It's the things that make us look good that God invites us to actually keep those things secret, to do them just for God. So a couple of practical suggestions for this week. There are more in the Advent guide. But what would it look like this week to honestly assess your motivations? As uncomfortable as those "am I a hypocrite" questions were, maybe that's exactly what you need to wrestle with this week. To invite the Holy Spirit into your inner heart, to reveal places in your heart that are addicted to approval. What would it look like to give a gift anonymously as we hit year end? To have that random gift show up under the tree without a tag? To give a gift to your neighbors, leave it on their doorstep? Or to simply just make a donation at the year end that comes from a bank check that can't be traced back to you, that can't be put on your taxes, that's just fully just given to give? What would it look like this week to highlight other people on your social media accounts? Find good stories and ways to complement what other people are doing. And then lastly, what would it look like to choose to be vulnerable with somebody? Maybe you've got that friendship that's kind of been on the verge, and there's an invitation this week to trust them a little bit deeper, to go a little bit deeper, to share the thing you're struggling with or wrestling with, and inviting a friend to come alongside of you so you don't have to carry that burden alone. What I find fascinating is that what Jesus talks about in all of these examples, and he repeats it three times once again, is that as we practice these things in secret, our Father will reward us. And what's really cool, and you completely miss in the English translation, is that the Greek word for reward here is different than the other one. It's not talking about dues being paid, but instead it's about giving away for one's own profit. There's a sense of paying back something. Rather than a contract, rather than just dues paid for a job, this feels a little bit more like investing. And honestly, it makes me think of the love of God. That the reward we're given is spiritual, is bigger, and is eternal, and grows. That God, as he sees what we do in secret, rewards us, gives us something that is going to profit and expand and multiply. Now, that doesn't always guarantee in the physical or in the health. God does those things sometimes, but sometimes it doesn't work like that. But there's a deeper reward of the affirmation that we really want and that we're really longing for as Christ reminds us who we really are, the original blessing that we were given when we were created, the love that was showered upon us on the cross, and the resurrection life that we're invited into. It's not a reward that's one and done and over, but it's a reward that expands and grows and continues. Sacred sharing is about decluttering our motivations. Really, it's a simple question of why do you do the things that you do? Whose approval are you seeking? Who's getting the applause? What reward do I really want? We want the temporary reward that comes and goes. Do we want the eternal, permanent reward that will always stay? Let's pray together. God, we just acknowledge that this kind of sharing in our lives is hard. God, I think with all of these practices, I mean, they're all challenging. They're all countercultural. God, they can feel awkward. They can feel uncomfortable to do. God, we just ask for freedom from the way the world has told us to seek approval. God, we pray for the number of questions that were thrown out, that God, those won't lead to guilt or to shame, but Jesus, you would use those questions to just root something else out in our lives, that we would be led to a deeper life, a more fulfilling life. God, we pray for our giving, for our praying, for our fasting, for our acts of righteousness. God, may you lead us to a place of pure motivations for those things. God, I pray for the things in our lives that we're holding tight, the secrets that we're ashamed of. God, I pray for freedom from those things here this morning as well. That God, you would just open us up to that one friend, that family member that we can really, truly confide in, so that God, we don't have to carry that burden by ourselves. We thank you that you come alongside of us to carry burdens as well. You say that your yoke is easy and the burden is light. So may we experience that this Christmas of things that we've been reluctant to share, but that God, we don't have to be ashamed of anymore. And so just lead us into freedom. God, ultimately, fill us with your affirmation. Speak to us about who we are, how much we are loved, how special we are. And thank you for just being able to be here. Bless us as we go to the table now together. In Jesus' name.